H. Barnes was engaged in a scene of swordplay with an actor named William Rignold. So many good names.
Is Rignold?
It is. It's Rignold. I wanted it to be Reginald so bad. Yeah. Barnes had accidentally thrust his sword directly into Rignold's chest. Fortunately, though, there was a doctor in attendance that evening, but the wound was supposedly rather serious, according to reports.
Generally, wounds to the chest are not great.
Yeah, I mean, if you put a sword in my chest, like, I don't think it's a Band-Aid type of situation.
No. You can't just have your mom kiss it and it goes away.
Yeah, you don't put a Hello Kitty Band-Aid over it and it goes away. In 1934, actor Malcolm Keane turned mute on stage, and his replacement, Alistair Sim, like those before him, had developed a high fever and had been hospitalized.
Okay.
1936, this is a big one. During an Orson Welles production in which he reimagined Macbeth as a voodoo-themed production, where it was set in Haiti and it was performed by an all-black cast.
Okay.
A genuine witch doctor was enlisted as part of the cast. Theater critic Percy Hammond, who worked for, I believe it was the New York Times. He was a big deal, yeah. So he wrote a terrible review of the show. And within a couple of weeks, Percy Hammond was dead.
What was so wrong with that show that he wrote such a terrible review?
Because it was different and imaginative, I'm sure. I don't know, that's just my thought, because I'm thinking of like the 1930s and how
I was kind of worried it would harken back to massive amount of racism.
The all-black cast. Some said that Orson Welles had a voodoo curse put on Percy purposely.
Huh.
Others believe that it may have just been the curse of Macbeth.
Okay.
In 1937, the theatrical legend Lillian Bayless took on the role of Lady Macbeth. On the night of the show's final dress rehearsal, Lillian suffered a heart attack and died.
Oh, no.
Years later, that theater hung a portrait of Lillian during a different production of Macbeth, just in the main lobby where people could see her and to pay homage to her. But that portrait reportedly did not want to stay on the wall, as it would fall down every time somebody would put it back up, as though she did not want to be there and she did not want to be a part of the production.
I could see that. I wouldn't be super jazzed about reliving the space where I died.
So in 1942, during a production that happened in Chicago, an audience member was struck with a prop that had gone flying off stage during one of the fight scenes. Upon being struck by the prop, the man began to spasm and had a massive heart attack and died right on the spot.
What theater was that?
I don't know. It didn't say. So in 1952, during a production that happened in Stratford, Lady Macbeth was performing her sleepwalking scene and went right off the stage into an orchestra pit, as though she was in a trance, although she was an actor playing a part in which she had been sleepwalking.
Right.
However, the actor died from sustained injuries of falling into an orchestra pit.
Well, it depends on how deep they are.
And sometimes they are very deep. Sometimes they're 6, 7, 8 feet, so that men who are like me and are 6'4" can stand up and not obstruct the view of the audience.
Yeah.
Fear not, though. If you are an actor and you have made the mistake of uttering the name Macbeth during your production, there is a way to lift the curse and protect yourself and others from harm.
Uh-huh.
This is my favorite part of the story. You don't even know. Actors have been doing this for years, apparently. Step one, you have to exit the theater completely. Like, you have to go outside, okay? Step two, you have to spin around 3 times.
Okay.
Step three, you have to spit on the ground. Some traditions believe that you have to spit over your left shoulder, but the traditions vary.
That's very tough, I feel, unless you're really good at spitting.
It'd be a little bit difficult for me. Step four, and the last step, you either need to recite a line of Shakespeare or unleash the most foul profanities you can think of.
I've heard about the exiting of the theater, and I've heard about the profanity on several occasions, but I hadn't heard about the spitting.
As it turns out, I found quite a few articles, and a lot of them matched up. The only differences I could find were the thing about, do you spit on the ground or over your shoulder? And then the thing about, do you recite Shakespeare or do you shout profanities? I always want to run outside, spin around 3 times, spit on something, and then shout fuck at the top of my lungs.
Yeah, that's true.
Really confuse the neighbors, you know?
I mean, clearly you know me, and I'm like a llama, so spinning is not an issue for me.
Okay, so now this goes into what we were talking about earlier with my friend. I believe she's still in London right now. She's been there for a while. She was actually finishing her grad study program there. She is a magnificent actress, and her name is Morgan. Right before we started recording, I sent her a message, and I asked her if she had ever been in a production of Macbeth, and I told her that I was doing a story about the curse, and if she had any experience with it, or if any of her friends had, because you're doing a grad study program, you're a thespian. As luck would have it, she responded to me and said that not only did she have an experience with Macbeth because she was in it, but she also had a ghost story that tied into it.
That's awesome.
I'm going to read you the message that she sent me when I asked her to tell me her ghost story.
Okay.
So she said, in the words of Miss Morgan, "So I was witch number 3, Anne Fleance. My director didn't believe in the Macbeth curse, and he would say his name out of context all the time. And he would laugh because nothing went wrong and nobody got hurt, etc. Our show was set right after World War I, and the focus of our show was really PTSD, because Macbeth hella has it. Our Lady Macbeth was and still is everyone's life goals. She is a phenomenal actress. The ghost story part happens on opening night. During the ball scene, I was one of the only, or maybe the only, cast member that wasn't on stage because of logistics and helping the other witches change back. All of a sudden, I hear a weird sound on the backstage intercom while I'm in the dressing room. Then all of a sudden there's yelling. Then a shit ton of people freaking out, and the costume designer, she's a goddess by the way, appear, and they're like, watch the dress, Lady Macbeth. The assistant stage manager, the costume designer, and other casting crew members burst into the room with Lady Macbeth's nose dripping with blood. Lady Macbeth's gown was made of golden silk, and she did not get a drop of blood on it, praise be, but she looked really dazed. So what had happened was, her and Macbeth exited upstage center, and the floor lights hit her eyes in such a way that despite having her arm hooked with Macbeth's, she fell down a flight of stairs.
Holy cow.
And hit her face on the door of the floor light.
Oh, no.
When the director came back and said that we could now stop the show if we had to, and he apologized, by the way, to everybody for saying the name Macbeth so many times throughout the production.
Yeah, no kidding.
People continued to carry on, and Lady Macbeth even went and kneeled on the grate and delivered her big Lady Macbeth monologue. Flawlessly, mind you, because she's a trooper. My parents, by the way, were in the audience that night, and they said that they saw her fall, but they thought it wasn't anything big. During the commotion, the ASM, which I'm assuming means assistant stage manager,
yes,
ran out into a hallway to find the head of our tech department. And when she ran out there, the hallway was completely empty, but then she heard a noise behind her. When she turned back and looked down the hallway, which had previously been empty, there was a Kleenex box on the floor.
Huh.
Literally no one was there before that, but what happened was, it was our theater ghost, Archibald MacLeod, and he came to help.
That's adorable.
So the actress who played Lady Macbeth went to the hospital afterwards, and she was diagnosed with a concussion, a broken nose, a sprained wrist, and she had cuts and bruises all over her knees, and a really big one on her nose.
Of course. Oftentimes when you break your nose, depending on how severe it is, there's a cut on your nose anyway.
Truth.
Because fact. Of the bone moving underneath your skin.
Ooh.
Or, well, not the bone, but the cartilage.
So before that happened, another character had also entered and tripped, falling during her only scene.
Oh no.
So that happened before Lady Macbeth's big fall. But the curse had clearly been focused on and really had a good go at Lady Macbeth during this production, as she was the one who was injured the worst. But back to that stage ghost, our token theater ghost, MacLeod. He would play tricks on my one friend in particular, who is a stage manager. The things that would happen to her regularly were that she would have this special pen that she would use, and it would go missing all the time, only to turn up in strange places. It was mostly playful stuff like that. He would do it before and after the production of Macbeth. So he would especially play by turning on the ghost light, which, for non-theater folk, is a single light on stage that lives in the center, and stays on all night for safety and so that the ghosts who live in the theater can perform when no one is there. The ghost light would turn on and off on her during the production of Macbeth. And when it would turn off, my friend would walk on stage and just say, "Archibald," and it would turn back on.
That's very cute.
I bore witness to this as I would sometimes come and hang out and wait for her as we were housemates. And I saw it too. That light would also flicker quite a bit. That's and that's really the cute. End of the story. That's the curse of Macbeth.
That was good.
I'm happy you liked it.
Yeah, I liked it a lot.
You did true crime this week. Do you want to do the cheers?
I'm going to do my general standby.
Okay.
Whether or not you're gay, please join us. Simply cheers, queers.
I love it. Cheers.
Cheers.
Well, if you'd like to cheers with us on social media, we are on Instagram. We're Shots in the Dark Podcast.
We are on Twitter and Snapchat, both at Shots in the Dark P.
You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/Shots in the Dark Pod.
You can email us at shotsinthedarkpodcast@gmail.com.
And that being said, we love feedback. We love hearing from people. If you know something about one of our stories that we didn't mention or maybe don't know ourselves, shoot us an email, let us know. Or if you want to let us know something you think that we should talk about because you find something really fascinating.
And on that same note, because we do like the feedback, we ask that you please, please review us on iTunes and also on Google Play.
That's so helpful for us because leaving us reviews and writing us reviews, it helps to grow the community because the more good reviews we get, the more it's possible for other people to find our show.
And it helps us to be able to change things that maybe you don't love so much too.
From both of us here at Shots in the Dark Podcast, we hope we've left you shaken.
Not stirred.
Bye.
Bye.
Making my way downtown.
No.
I love you.
I love you back.